Like millions of other people who hate dogs, I'm sick and tired of seeing them everywhere I go. I understand some dogs are trained to perform tasks for the disabled and improve their quality of life, and that's good for the disabled who have service dogs. But what about everyone else in society? Dogs are now allowed into public places which were strictly off limits to them just 20 years ago. 20 years ago, it seemed only highly trained, seeing eye dogs were granted access to stores, public transit, and other public places that generally don't allow dogs. But this epidemic of emotional support dogs has really taken hold, and it is now completely out of control. You see these dogs everywhere with their working vests on. I wonder, is their presence in public places truly justified? Why are all these people bringing these dogs everywhere, and how are they getting away with it? For me and many others, it's infuriating. I wonder how would people feel if they were seeing snakes everywhere? Many people are very uncomfortable around snakes. Therefore, the presence of snakes in public places is not tolerated. Well, a lot of people are afraid of dogs in the same way people are afraid of snakes. Cynophobia, the crippling fear of dogs, affects 1 in 20 people. 1 in 20 is not an insignificant number. No one considers these people and their feelings. What about their rights? When people bring their dogs into classrooms or libraries for children to read to, as though they're doing the kids a favor, are they thinking about the 1 in 20 kids who are terrified of dogs? No. And when these dog nuts bring their therapy dogs into hospitals or old age homes and force them on everyone, are they considering the feelings of those 1 in 20? No, they're not. And they need to. Why can people have emotional support dogs but not emotional support snakes? Or peacocks, like the one named Dexter that wasn't allowed to board a United Airlines flight last year. All kinds of animals have been spotted boarding planes in recent years, including pigs and turkeys. I think the whole aviation industry has gone completely bonkers. Airplanes have now become zoos, they're barnyards. It's beyond outrageous and disgusting. 61% of flight attendants say emotional support animals have caused trouble mid-flight. These animals often urinate and/or defecate in the plane, filling the cabin with stench. They bark, they lunge at people, they bite passengers, they wander around the cabin. I feel like this is a dream, and I can't understand how it has come to this and how this is tolerated. It doesn't even seem real. Just 20 years ago, it would have been unthinkable. Allergies to dogs and cats affect 10 to 20% of the population worldwide, according to this study I found on the NCBI website. That is also not an insignificant number. There are people with hygiene standards who wish to eat a meal without dog hair, dander, nasal mucus, and slobber landing on their food when a dog shakes itself or sneezes. We would never allow people into restaurants if they weren't wearing underwear. We don't even allow them into a restaurant without a shirt or shoes on. Then why allow dogs in? Dogs don't wear underwear. When dogs sit down, their dirty anuses contaminate everything they touch. Dog fur is contaminated with traces of urine, feces, and parasitic eggs. And this contaminates everything the dogs touch. Even dogs that appear to be healthy are often infested with worms and are shedding parasitic eggs, which can last for months or even years in the environment, as I discussed in my video about how virtually all dogs are infested with worms to some degree. There are many of us who don't wish to expose ourselves to this filth. What about our rights? What gives dog owners the rights to force their disgusting lifestyle on us? Now, there's a difference between service dogs, emotional support dogs, therapy dogs, and companion dogs. A service dog helps individuals perform tasks they cannot do for themselves because of a disability. These dogs are trained, to perform specific jobs for their disabled owners. The disabilities can vary greatly, and so do the tasks that the service dogs perform. For example, there are dogs that are trained to help the hearing and visually impaired. Diabetic alert dogs alert to changes in their handler's blood sugar levels. People who suffer from PTSD, can have service dogs that are trained to wake them up from nightmares. Seizure response dogs can help a person who is having a seizure by barking for help or pressing an alarm system. And people with mobility issues can have service dogs that are trained to turn off lights, press buttons on automatic doors, retrieve keys, and so forth. I read these dogs can be trained to deliver their owner's wallets to cashiers by placing their paws up on the till, standing on their hind legs while holding the wallet in their mouth. Could you imagine being a cashier and having to touch the slimy, disgusting wallet that had just been in the dog's bacteria-filled mouth? What a nightmare. And then the dog placing its dirty paws up on the till where food is placed. The dog has all kinds of bacteria on its paws. This is an outrage. Anyway, autism support dogs are trained to keep children from running away and can often track children if they do run off. These are all examples of service dogs. Emotional support dogs are dogs that provide comfort and support in the form of affection and companionship to an individual suffering from various mental and emotional conditions. They are allowed in airplanes and rentals that would otherwise ban pets. A landlord can't turn you away if you have a legitimate emotional support animal. Therapy dogs are dogs that are used in hospital settings or nursing homes to bring comfort to those who are ill or under poor conditions, such as those who have been affected by a natural disaster. A companion dog describes a dog that does not work but provides companionship as a pet. It doesn't perform any specific tasks, and any dog can be a companion dog. To have an ESA, or emotional support animal, an owner simply needs to have a legitimate doctor's note stating their disability and how the animal in question provides support. The note can be over the phone or even online. The ease of this process means people have been claiming all sorts of animals as necessary support systems, flashing their notes to bring dogs to the movies or a kangaroo into McDonald's. Personally, I would much rather see a kangaroo in a public place than a dog, because a kangaroo won't shred up your face or rip your limbs off. And unlike dogs, I think they're actually really cute. I mean, look at this guy. And they kill these adorable animals to make dog food to feed to dogs. Where's the sense in that? Even peacocks look way prettier, smell better, and like kangaroos, they won't disfigure or kill you. It goes on to say that this has also led to abuse of the system. The article says, that which I'm going to link you to, I'm going to put all kinds of links in the description box for you to read, that many believe an ESA note to be law, allowing animals like turtles, snakes, and llamas into restaurants, museums, and department stores. But the law only states that these animals are allowed on planes, with limitations, and in buildings that otherwise do not allow pets. I wonder how many museum curators, restaurant managers, and department store employees are aware of this. They need to be made aware of the law so that they can turn away people who are abusing the system. Certain states provide their own laws about bringing emotional support dogs into public places. It's all very confusing. So check your local government for the rules. We cannot allow these dog nuts to get away with breaking the law any longer. Being in the presence of a dog really puts a lot of people on edge and can ruin their flight or shopping experience, or even their ability to enjoy their own apartment. If a person wants to live in a dog-free building because they have a fear of dogs, they can't anymore, because no landlord can turn away tenants with emotional support dogs. No place feels safe for people who are afraid of dogs. And remember, they're 1 in 20. They don't feel comfortable in their own apartment buildings because they're running into dogs in the elevator and the lobby. They can't avoid dogs. These dogs are often poorly trained and bark incessantly, destroying the quality of life for millions of people. What about our right to feel safe and comfortable and enjoy peace and quiet in our own living space? Nope, to hell with us. Dog owners' rights override ours. A lot of people have PTSD due to being attacked by a dog or witnessing a friend or relative being attacked or killed by a dog. It has been estimated that the likelihood of a child sustaining a dog bite in their lifetime is 50%, according to this analysis of pediatric facial dog bites. The number of people who therefore feel uncomfortable around dogs or whose symptoms of PTSD are triggered by the presence of dogs has got to be high. 1 in 20 have a crippling fear of dogs, but how many people have a fear that isn't crippling, but does raise their anxiety level and makes them feel uncomfortable? What about their mental health? As a culture, we don't care about their emotional or mental health. or the physical health of these people, because it's the same for people with severe allergies. They have no rights. Airlines will sometimes try to assign you a different seat to put space between you and the animal if you complain about it, but it's not always guaranteed that you will get another seat. And the enclosed space and shared air makes it so that no matter where you are seated, the very presence of a dog in the cabin of an airplane will make you sick if you suffer from allergies. Dogs are now allowed into assisted living facilities, classrooms, taxis, and other places where their dander can trigger severe allergic responses in people, sending them into respiratory distress even. Even after the dog has been removed from the environment. I'm linking you to an article that explains how common dogs are on flights nowadays and how planes are not deep cleaned very often. Even if there is no dog on the plane, you'll still have dander on the plane. And if you're highly allergic, you will react to it. This can make people feel miserable during their flight. They have to take their allergy medication, suffer the side effects of that medication, suck it up, and put up with the dog's negative impact on their health, because some person requires a dog for their health is granted more rights for some reason. This is so unfair. I was reading the comments on this article, which explains the laws regarding service dogs in Canada. The article states that guide dogs are allowed into places where food is served and sold, but other animals are excluded by law in Canada. They're still allowed on Canadian flights, which serve food, which makes no sense. But anyway, in the comments, someone wrote that his son has severe allergy-induced asthma and is highly allergic to dog dander. The person works as a rideshare driver and picked up a person with a guide dog. By law, he is not allowed to turn away or deny service to people with service animals. He says that after cleaning his car, his son got into the car the next day and had respiratory trouble. He asks if this is fair. People in the comments are telling him he chose the wrong job. This is ridiculous. What if he had another job, but his son got into an Uber or taxi or airplane that had a dog in it the day before? Like millions of other people, I don't have a crippling phobia of dogs, but their presence disgusts me and makes me uneasy. I can't relax when there's a dog around. I go into fight or flight mode because I know what dogs are capable of. I know how unpredictable they are. I know how an emotional support dog latched onto Marlon Jackson's face as he was boarding a Delta Airlines flight in 2017 in what was a totally unprovoked attack, causing him to bleed so badly that an entire row of seats later had to be removed from the airplane. He suffered cuts and puncture wounds to his face and upper body, which needed 28 stitches. I'm also aware of 5-year-old Gabriela Gonzalez, who needed facial reconstruction after being mauled by a passenger's emotional support pit bull at the Portland International Airport in December 2017. The owner had given her permission to pet the dog when it suddenly bit her on the face. Her injuries were said to include a punctured eyelid, severed tear duct, and a torn lip. This is crazy. This is absolutely crazy that we allow these unpredictable animals into people's homes, never mind into public places. It's absolutely insane. And you'll find many articles that say this practice needs to stop because it is tarnishing the reputation of legitimate service dogs and their handlers. It's making business owners and the public at large view legit service dogs and their owners with prejudice. When these dogs are brought into public places and misbehave, sniff things they aren't supposed to sniff, approach people, pee or poop on the floor, bark, cause disruption, become aggressive, they give highly trained service dogs a bad name. The public recognizes this problem and they're signing bills making it illegal for people to misrepresent their pets as service animals. People who break the law now face fines and misdemeanor charges. This article talks about how crazy it's become. A person who volunteers at a performance venue talks about how they've had dogs bark through the whole show, sit in the middle of the aisle, and even hump the legs of a stranger. Can you imagine? How do we as a society tolerate this? I just can't believe how sick our culture has become, and they call me crazy. Business owners, according to federal law, can only ask two questions of anyone who says they have a service dog. Is it a service animal, and what is it trained to do? Those are the only two questions they can ask. By law, they cannot ask for documentation, and they cannot ask about the person's disability. That makes the laws difficult to enforce. Are business owners and restaurants really going to go after people who claim their dog is a service or support animal? If it has a vest, or if the owner says it's helping them, they won't. They don't want to get sued, the article says. So there's a supposed crackdown on fake service animals, but the new laws are difficult to enforce. I question if they are being enforced at all. It says, quote, because most business owners won't risk a lawsuit by asking about specifics, legislators and advocates are simply hoping that their laws will discourage support and service animal scammers, end quote. They are hoping. What the hell? They hope their laws will discourage scammers. How about we change the law so that business owners are allowed to ask for specifics? This is what I don't get. Why can they not ask for documentation? I just don't understand this. If it is such a problem and everyone agrees it is, why not make it so business owners cannot be sued if they ask for documentation and specifics? They should be able to. I think this is absolutely freaking ridiculous. It needs to be much, much easier to enforce these laws. Legitimate service dogs that are trained to help their owners by performing specific tasks are allowed to go everywhere, no questions asked. This comes with the assumption that service dogs are highly trained. Now again, the laws are different for each country. The servicedogscanada.org website states that there is no legal requirement for a service dog to be trained by a professional trainer in order to have public access rights. A person with a disability has the right to train his or her own service dog, either with the help of a trainer or without. The owner and the service dog may not be denied access to any public facility as long as they meet two requirements. The owner has a disability and the dog is trained to assist the person. It says on their site that there is no such thing as a governmental authority or agency certifying service dogs in Canada. All you need to do to register your dog as a legitimate service animal is visit this website, click in a box to verify that your dog meets certain requirements, whip out your credit card, and boom, they will send you the official vest and service dog certificate. It says, Service Dogs Canada recognizes that you may train your own dog and supplies you with the appropriate identification to allow your dog to accompany you in public. Now, anyone can do this. No one is going to assess your dog or put it through any sort of test to determine that it is adequately trained. You can totally lie on this application, click the box that says your dog meets the requirements when it doesn't, and still get the vest and the certification that will allow you to call your dog a certified service dog. I'm not talking about an emotional support dog here. I am talking about a legitimate service dog that is trained to help you with a disability and follow you everywhere in public. The Assistance Dogs of America website provides instant registration and documentation for your assistance dog in the same manner. It provides documents for both the United States and Canada. This is completely unregulated. I didn't know this. It says service dogs can be trained by their owners or in any other manner the owner desires to assist them with their disability. I checked Australian law, and it says here that while some accreditation systems operate in the state and territory jurisdictions, the Federal Disability Discrimination Act of 1992 contains no requirement for accreditation and overrides state and territory laws. A person can thus claim their animal is protected as an assistance animal without any form of accreditation. So just like in the USA and Canada, a dog does not have to be certified or registered in order to be recognized as a service animal in Australia. All you need to show is that you are disabled and that the dog assists you by performing tasks for you. Emotional support animals are not recognized under Australian law, which is one of the reasons I want to move there. If you're in the UK, you cannot train a service dog yourself. In order to qualify as a service dog, it must be trained and certified through Assistance Dogs International or the International Guide Dog Foundation. Organizations belonging to Assistance Dogs UK have all been accredited by these two groups and are acceptable channels through which you can obtain service animals. The UK also does not recognize emotional support animals. Good for you guys. Keep it that way. But here is something you should all know about. I found this article on usatoday.com entitled Service Dog Trainers Are Barely Regulated, Leading to Incompetence and Fraud. It talks about an autistic child who had crippling anxiety, so her parents got her a service dog from a North Carolina state-approved service dog trainer with a specialty in autism service dogs for children called RICON, which its brochure stated was a certified program. They paid $14,500 for the dog, which they named Okami, which pulled on its leash, refused to lie down, growled and lunged at people at the mall. And one day, 10 months after bringing the dog home, they opened the front door and the dog broke free from the father's grasp and began mauling one of the family's elderly dogs as the little girl watched from the stairs in horror. The article says it was only after they had returned the dog and asked for a refund that they learned that the person who trained the dog was not a state-certified dog trainer. In fact, North Carolina has no such certification program. And neither does any other state. Some customers claimed they arrived at Rycon to find dogs emaciated, skittish, and matted with urine and feces. Many say their pups lunged and nipped at children and other animals. And it isn't just Rycon. In 2012, the state of Illinois sued Lee Cadis and Animals for Autism over a, quote, heartless scam in which she took several thousand dollars from families but never matched them with dogs. 2 years ago, Noelle's Dogs for Hope of Colorado Springs agreed to surrender its license after state inspectors confirmed the placement of dogs with, quote, incontinence, lack of basic house training, separation anxiety, and aggression. And last year, Virginia Attorney General Mark Herring filed suit against Service Dogs by Warren Retrievers, Inc. The lawsuit alleges that the diabetes alert dogs, for which Warren charged up to $27,000, were often poorly trained, ill-behaved, and unequipped to help manage a life-threatening situation, rendering them little more than incredibly expensive pets. So there's really no way to know if the highly trained service dog you're spending thousands of dollars for is going to be well-trained. It may very well maul you or attack your pets and loved ones out of the blue. The article mentions a girl named Katie who suffered from severe PTSD and anxiety. The family waited a year for their service dog, and once home with them in Toronto, the dog showed extreme aggression towards Katie's older brother. An expert who examined the dog declared it unfit for service, and the dog was taken away. The girl later killed herself. And what happened to Okami? The trainer they returned it to sold the dog to another family. With similar results, the article says. This is how mentally sick these dog nuts are. Deceptive, manipulative, uncaring, selfish. It says the service dog industry has exploded in recent years, but a near complete absence of regulation and oversight has left needy, desperate families vulnerable to incompetence and fraud. It is a lawless area, the Wild West. And then there's also the question of how necessary service dogs really are. I have no doubt that some service dogs do help people in some ways, but are there really no alternatives to having a service dog? It really seems to me that there are often better, safer ways of accomplishing many of the jobs service dogs perform. As I said in previous videos, there are many different ways to manage anxiety and panic attacks, including grounding techniques, mindfulness, CBT, DBT, physical exercise, meditation, therapy, counseling, medication. The list goes on and on. Have these people with psychiatric service dogs really exhausted all of their other options? They have seizure alert devices now that alert other people when you're having a seizure. There are mattress, watch, camera, and motion devices that can alert others to your seizures. There's actually no scientific evidence dogs can predict seizures before they occur. All of the so-called evidence is purely anecdotal. I really suspect dog nuts are desperate to find use for their dogs when these stinking, slobbering mutants are actually useless. The only scientific evidence dogs are able to detect seizures while they are imminent or currently happening is a, quote, small and intriguing new study that suggests people with epilepsy emit a specific odor when they are having seizures, and dogs can be trained to detect it. This article from PBS.org says that dogs trained to detect epileptic seizures may even cause harm. Researchers reported one case in which a patient's dog supposedly alerted him 7 minutes before his seizures, but those turned out to be psychosomatic, non-epileptic episodes that were reinforced by the alerts. And now they have what they call continuous glucose monitors that help diabetics monitor their blood sugar levels and can alert up to 5 different people of blood sugar lows and highs before they occur, day and night. No need for a dog. They say autism service dogs help by applying deep pressure stimulation, which is shown to help. This is a fancy way of saying the dog is leaning on you, but you can apply the same sort of pressure with weighted vests and weighted blankets that are sold for this purpose. They even have seeing eye robot canes now that assist the visually impaired. This is the future. Soon, seeing eye dogs will be obsolete, as will all service dogs. The future, as I always say, is dog-free. It seems to me dog lovers are trying desperately to find more and more uses for dogs when they are actually unnecessary. Scientists are developing artificial intelligence that can more safely and hygienically do the jobs dogs do. In this article from scientificamerican.com, Tim Edwards, behavioral analyst and senior lecturer at a university in New Zealand, which I probably won't be able to pronounce correctly, says he's hopeful that if dogs can detect seizure odors, eventually humans can get artificial intelligence to do the job. Service dogs make up only 0.56% of the dog population. Approximately 500,000 service dogs are helping people in the USA. And this article talks about how people are traveling to faraway places like Mongolia to promote the use of service dogs. This reminds me of missionaries who go to places where the native population is doing just fine and trying to convert them to their superior religion and way of life. They introduce ideas and practices that ultimately end up destroying these cultures, causing major harm and trauma through the establishment of residential schools, for example, carrying out horrible abuses under the guise of doing good. Anyway, so 500,000 service dogs in America. In 2017, a total of about 89.7 million dogs lived in households in the United States as pets. Therefore, only 0.56% of the dogs in the United States are service dogs. The ubiquitous presence of poorly trained emotional support dogs is clearly a huge problem, but genuine service dogs need not be our focus at the moment because they make up such a tiny percentage of the dog population. What we must focus on is ridding our society of the remainder of the dog population, the 99.44% of dogs that are menaces to society. The idea behind emotional support dogs and service dogs is that they are meant to improve the quality of life of those who need them. But the laws that shelter the disabled from discrimination and allow the presence of dogs in public places, as well as the absence of regulation when it comes to service dogs, are diminishing the quality of life for the rest of us. The laws that prohibit business owners from asking certain questions or requesting documentation are supposedly in place to ensure everyone is treated fairly. But in order to treat everyone fairly, we need to extend our consideration to the people who are anxious and uncomfortable around dogs, as well as the people who are allergic to dogs. They matter too. As awareness grows and as we evolve, as we become more civilized as a species, and as we continue to develop artificial intelligence to do the jobs service dogs do, the future will become dog-free.